Marc Coleman here from Unleash. I'm absolutely delighted and very, very excited to be talking to Vivek Wadhwa, a distinguished fellow at Harvard Law School of Labor and Work-Life Programs. Vivek, welcome to the show.
Hello, dear friend. Glad to be on with you.
It's been a while since we did an interview. It's not been so long since we actually spoke. How are you keeping?
I'm doing fine. I mean, it's been a crazy year. I mean, as you know, But I just got vaccinated and I'm itching to start traveling again.
You're no stranger to Unleash, Vivek. Can you tell our audience, though, can you give us a little bit of context here of what your work looks like today?
Yeah, you know, I research and I teach advancing technologies, how everything from AI, robotics, sensors, networks, all these technologies are coming together and disrupting industries. So at CMU, what I've been teaching is the basics of technologies and the opportunities for students to make the world a better place. I also do corporate workshops for big businesses, for billion-dollar companies across the globe. And I teach the CEOs and executive teams of big companies that, look, you either have to realize that change is happening or you become toast. And it's not a pretty sight. On the one hand, you have trillion-dollar opportunities. On the other hand, entire industries are going to be wiped out. So here are some new innovation methods.
The world of work has completely changed in the last 11 months. And since I last did an interview with you, it was about 4 years ago in NASA Research Park in Menlo. You talked about a Star Trek world and a Mad Max world. Have we gotten there faster? Have we stepped into a time machine with COVID?
Marc, look at what happened at Capitol Hill over here. Who could have imagined that the capital of the United States would be overrun by rioters, that the president of the United States would be accused of launching a coup, right? This is not Mad Max. I don't know what is. On the other hand, when the pandemic first started, you had experts saying that it'll take 30 years to develop a vaccine, and it's never been done before. Best case, 5 years. And people like me were arguing that it will get done this year. I mean, in fact, I went on national TV and I predicted that by the end of the year, we'll have at least one or more vaccines. And people thought I was nuts. The fact is that within weeks, we had developed a vaccine. It took a few months after that to test it out. But we were able to now come up with a vaccine for COVID in record time. And what's more, we developed the platform, the technologies to cure any disease within record time. So you had Star Trek and you had Mad Max at the same time. I mean, a year, 4 years ago when we had our, lively discussion, we were using big fat video cameras and we couldn't have envisaged that we would be meeting people online like this. It would become a norm for us to be interacting on, Zoom or any of these other online services. And be working, with each other the way we do. The fact that grandma would be talking about exponential curves, as would junior, right? This was, not even conceivable 4 years ago. Yet it happened.
That exponential curve that we're talking about, and exponential technologies. We've talked about job losses back then. We were talking about the driverless car. Much has changed since then. I think COVID wiped out probably more jobs than we could have ever predicted. The robots could. What's likely to happen as we move into the 20s? Is it going to be the roaring 20s? And are we still in a case of leaders are going to either thrive or die?
Marc, it's going to be different all over the world. I mean, if you're in the United States and if you're in India, if you're in Latin America, you're in good shape because, these technologies are going to make incredible things possible. The self-driving cars we've been talking about are taking 2 or 3 years longer than I hoped. But in the next 2 or 3 years, they'll be self-driving. Even Apple is now talking about having an Apple car and an all-electric self-driving Apple car. So these things are now becoming real. In the next 5 years, we will start seeing them taking over our roads, which means we have to build these new cars. We're going to have robots. We need to build these robots. So in many of these economies, we're going to be building all of these new technologies. In Europe also, we're going to be building a lot of new technologies, building a new infrastructure. So you end up creating jobs in the short term. And then what happens when the robots are building robots, 3D printers are 3D printing 3D printers, we're now synthetically growing food and we can cure disease and stuff like that, we're going to need far fewer people working. But that's in the 2030s, so we don't have to worry about that. Now, at the same time, one of the things which I've been talking about for a long time is this era of clean energy. The fact is that the planet is heating up, that, you know, we are seeing global warming. Where I live in Silicon Valley, I live right next to a national park, and I have a bag packed just in case the forest fire burns my house down, because global warming has wreaked havoc on California. So what we have to do is we've got to accelerate the move to renewables. The fact is that the price of oil has now dropped to points that were, you know, not considered likely a few years ago. And the price is going to continue dropping because clean energy is now on this exponential path. And within the next 5 years or so, the cost of clean energy will be cheaper than alternatives worldwide. So we have a chance to save the planet. So that's good for the planet. But what happens to the oil producing economies? Toast. Right.
Toast.
So you start looking worldwide at these advances and you begin to realize that just as the pandemic caught us by surprise, people didn't believe in exponentials. You had world leaders such as the guy in the White House here saying that this is a hoax. It's not real. You know, it's going to go away. I mean, this is worldwide. We saw leaders saying similar things. Yet, you know, you now have hundreds of thousands of people who died from it and, you know, tens of millions who've been infected worldwide. It caught up by surprise. People didn't understand the power of exponentials and they caught up with us. That's the way it goes now. Exponential advances are happening not only in viruses, but in key technologies.
Right. And it's brought a big issue, you know, up as the life-work balance, or what used to be called work-life balance. You've lost a few tech giants in California recently. Palantir, Oracle have moved. Your good friend,
Mark, I think. Mark, they moved on paper. Yeah, I know. This is all on paper. I don't buy this nonsense about we're moving away and we're never coming back. Complete nonsense. They're doing it for tax purposes. And even this work from home is a temporary phenomena. You visited me at CMU, okay? At CMU, where I've been teaching my exponential innovation course. It used to be, you know, every semester we would have maybe a dozen or so amazing startup ideas coming out of the classes. Because we would get our students to be in groups of five or six people, and they would challenge each other. They would, you know, brainstorm, bump into each other, overhear other groups, and come up with great ideas for startups. We were virtual last semester. Zero ideas for startups. Even though the class was ranked extremely highly, I mean, my class is always ranked amongst the highest in the university. This was ranked extremely highly. Zero startups. The innovation didn't happen. This is what the tech companies are realizing now, right now, saying, oh my God, maybe we can save some on office space, but the innovation ain't happening. So what you're going to find is that some jobs will now indeed be distributed. You can work from anywhere. If you're doing customer support, you can do that better from home because there's less pressure on you. You don't have to overhear people in the other cubicle. If you're doing quality assurance, you can do that from home as well. However, if you're trying to do things which require group work, you need to be together. If you want to innovate, you need to be together. Marketing people who, you know, do creative things need to be together. So it goes profession by profession. In some professions, you can have, you know, some of the people working remotely, but the people who need to be interacting with each other will be coming together. So we're going to come full cycle here. We'll probably have 20%. I'm making that number up. It's a random guess. 20%, you know, still being done remotely. The rest will be back at the office. And the other thing, okay, how do promotions happen? You're sucking up to your boss, right? I mean, you're showing off to your peers how good you are. Doesn't happen over Zoom, right?
Oh, yeah, very true. listen, it was 5% when we flew into the crisis. So 20%, that's interesting. Where are you getting that number from, do you mind?
I made it up, Mark. It's just a sort of gut feel. It isn't 40%. It isn't 10%. So it feels more like 20% is my guess as to what the balance is going to be. And it's going to depend on every industry, depend on every company. Some company, and also it's going to be, partial, that no one is going to, I tell you, even the QA people aren't going to want to be away from their bosses and their bosses' bosses for too long or from the development teams for too long because they're going to get left out. Because that's how it happens, that you go and you meet people, you socialize with them, you learn what's happening, you learn the gossip in the company, you learn who just left or who just got into trouble, who just got fired, and you gossip with each other. And that's the way our social networks work. And then you come up with ideas on how to make your projects better, make your company better, and you share it with your teams and with your bosses, and that's how you get promoted. You're not going to do that over Zoom because you basically have been relegated to never, never land. So people are going to want to come back to work so they can be part of the action again.
You were very positive the last time I spoke to you in terms of how quickly the world was going to get vaccinated. Are you still as positive, even though there's obviously been bumps in the road, but we've seen like 60% of Israel, I think, have been vaccinated now. United Arab Emirates are brilliant at this as well. And the UK's done a pretty good job, despite Boris getting lots of stick for it. Do you still work to the timelines we last spoke about?
Yeah, I think it's going to happen very rapidly because, you're going to have the haves and the have-nots. People who don't get vaccinated won't be able to travel to other countries in fact, companies, I know for a fact, there are a number of companies, because I've been talking to CEOs, they're thinking very seriously of having a policy saying that you can only come to the office if you've been vaccinated. So companies are going to be stepping down. They're debating it right now. They're discussing it. They're looking into the legalities of all of this. But they're going to start demanding that employees who come to the office must be vaccinated. We're going to have the travel authorities mandating that if you're going to travel to these places, you got to get vaccinated. So there's going to be pressure from that. And then what's more, people are going to talk to others who have been vaccinated and find that, look, these conspiracy theories we've been hearing are complete BS, especially for the new generation of vaccines. And why take the risk? Because the coronavirus can be devastating. I mean, it may be only 1% of the population, but it's young people as well as old people, and you can't always predict who's going to get hit bad by it, and then the long-term effects.
You've talked about the carnage of the next decade. I feel like that's a bit too pessimistic. How does the last 12 months stack up against what we're going to meet over the next 9 years?
Marc, what we saw in the last 12 months was a dress rehearsal for what's going to happen with the next decade with exponential technologies, because people have to understand that exponentials are happening. This device in my hand is my smartphone. This has more computing power than 100 Cray supercomputers. You and I know what Cray supercomputers are. Some of the young kids watching this may not know, but those were, like $20 million in the 1970s and the 80s, and $20 million was like $100 million today in those days. And they had export controls. You couldn't take them across the United States border because they were guarded by the government. This is like 100 times more powerful than those things were. And they required big rooms. Not only is computing advancing exponentially, everything that computing touches is advancing exponentially. Artificial intelligence, networks, sensors, robotics, digital medicine, synthetic biology, quantum computing, all of these things are on exponential paths. And when exponential technologies converge, they make the impossible possible. Digital medicine, just like we were able to now come up with treatments for COVID, vaccines for COVID, will start applying the same technologies to many other fields. And you're going to have digital medicine advancing exponentially. CRISPR, gene editing, is going to be on an exponential path. We're going to have vertical farms, which become practical because the cost of clean energy is dropping exponentially. So, and clean energy becomes cheaper and cheaper. Batteries become cheaper. Electric vehicles become cheaper. So you now essentially have all of these incredible advances happening and disrupting societies. So when clean energy becomes cheaper, you disrupt the society, the economies of the oil producers, right? When digital medicine becomes more powerful, you start being able to save people's lives and let them live healthier and happier. When the robots start taking over manufacturing and doing the work of workers in stocking shelves within supermarkets, you begin to create unemployment. When the self-driving cars start taking over the jobs of Uber workers, gig workers, you start dealing with unemployment, you start dealing with social unrest. So all of these things that we've seen over the last year are going to happen in different ways, because of different exponential curves over the next decade. It's going to be amazing in terms of what becomes possible and terrifying in terms of the dark sides.
People have also had a schooling on how to use these technologies. You and I have talked about how big tech has made these technologies more addictive. we've seen lots of evidence for that in the last months. But what I've seen come out of Silicon Valley recently, where normally, like the vaccine, it takes a long time to build enterprise products. We have customers that are now building those products in 6 to 8 weeks. which is phenomenal against just 12 months ago.
Marc, those customers need to read this book, From Incremental to Exponential, because I explain, I mean, this is actually part two of Driving the Driverless Car, which we've talked about before, which talks about, this is the basics of advancing technology. It tells you how they're advancing. This book is for corporate executives who want to now understand how, you know, what the $1 trillion opportunities are and how they need to rethink their entire development platforms and, you know, the processes and everything to be in line with exponential technologies.
You think big business understand all those exponential curves?
Some do. I mean, you know, in the book, for example, I had examples of the companies that really got it. You know, Microsoft, yes, everyone, you know, expects Microsoft to be doing amazing things, but NextEra Energy. NextEra Energy is a utility in Florida. I mean, it's the most valuable energy company in the world now because their CEO, Jim Robo, understood exponential curves. He's a student of mine, and I admire him, okay? I mean, and he reinvented the company, and their company, their stock price is off the charts. And then you look at Logitech. Logitech develops boring keyboards. It's become one of the most successful. Look at the stock price. Incredibly, doing incredibly well. I mean, Walmart, okay, the dumb old retailer that we thought was going to die. Walmart has become a hot company now. These are the type of companies that got it, whose CEOs, you know, were able to understand exponentials and take the bets. And then you have companies going out of business who have leaders who just don't get it, who are in denial that change is happening.
So we're in a never normal, Vivek, in all of this. As we're coming out of this crisis, what would be your message, especially to the HR profession? How do they need to change? How do they need to get ready for, you know, essentially when we flew into this, companies had a different tech radar. It didn't work. It fell flat. All the predictive models, all the predictive analytics, none of that stuff worked. As we come out of this, we're already seeing in our space an acceleration of productivity tools hitting the marketplace.
Yeah.
What's your guidance to the next generation of HR leaders?
Yeah, for there are two lessons here. First of all, the role of HR. The role of HR has increased exponentially because, you know, employment has been disrupted. Your employees are in a state of panic right now. They have no idea what hit them. Just like your jobs became extremely important when the pandemic happened because you had to guide the company through transition. Now you've got to guide the company through many transitions because you've got to figure out how they're going to come back to work, how you're going to provide them with counseling because a lot of them really, you know, have gone crazy being home and suffering the trauma of all this change. So you now have to understand the employees' needs and the trauma that they've been through and guide them from that perspective. And then you've got to realize that you're going to be disrupted also, my friends, unless you understand technology change and understand the new tools and techniques that are available and start understanding everything from what AI enables, which is data analysis and understanding the trends within your company and outside the company, to the new soft types of software that are available. You've got to adapt to the new methods and new processes and upgrade your own services, the services you're providing to the company. Otherwise, you're going to be unemployed. So, you know, so you're the disrupted as well as the disruptor, and you're the enabler of disruption within the company and change within the company. And you're also the guide and the guru. So you've got a really, really tough job.